Podcast. So this is Darren Pautrowitz. In the other window, we have a strapping, prolific author named Steve Farber. We will be joined by JJ French very shortly. Now, Steve co-wrote the new book with JJ. Steve, can you say the name of the book? Because it's going to sound better coming from your lips than mine.
You think so? I don't know. Yeah, the book is called Twisted Business, Lessons from My Life in Rock and Roll. And just to be clear, the subtitle, Lessons from My Life in Rock and Roll, even though I'm the co-author on the book, they are not lessons from my life in rock and roll, because I have no life in rock and roll. That's, of course, referring to JJ French, who is my dear friend and co-author. This is his story.
And not your first book, not your second book. You have what, 8 books?
Not yet. This is my 5th book, actually. The Radical Leap, The Radical Edge, Greater Than Yourself, a book called Love is Just Damn Good Business, and then Twisted Business. So from Love is Good Business to Twisted Business was the last little, you know, jump there.
And before JJ joined us, how did you and he first meet?
Yeah, we were, we actually met, oddly enough, at a business conference. So, you know, I've been in the world of leadership development for 30 years, and my typical playground is the corporate world. And I was speaking at a conference, and he was attending that conference because his girlfriend at the time, who's now his wife, was on a panel. So he came along, you know, to give her support. And also he's, you know, just a kind of a curious guy about business.
That curious guy who just joined us. Yes.
Speaking of curious guys, there he is. And I gave my talk about, which is fundamentally about the role that love plays in business. And I opened it up for Q&A. He grabbed the microphone, he stood up, and he said, I'm at a business that is not populated by people who run business the way you just described. But I do, he said. Yeah. And then he asked a question, and we started talking, and it was an immediate connection. That was probably, I'm guessing, what, 10 years ago? What do you think, JJ, 10 years ago?
Yeah, I mean, Sharon would probably, if we were having an argument, she'd give the exact date. Actually, yeah, probably, maybe 2012, you know, 2011, 2012, yeah.
Yeah, thereabouts.
Yeah, cool. So, by the way, my new guitar pick.
Oh, very cool. You know, we are live, JJ.
I know. I got
okay,
you.
Good.
I know. I'm fully aware.
Good. You're here and fully aware.
I know we're live because you just described our meeting in the most eloquent and non-controversial ways.
Non-colorful of ways.
Yeah, well, that's right. I have to say, not only thank you for joining us, congratulations on getting the book done, et cetera, but I think I'm like many people watching this, listening to this, et cetera, that go, hey, JJ, I've been listening to your music for much more of my life than not. So thank you for the many, many years of great music. And this talk is partially in conjunction with the Long Beach Public Library. A lot of the Nassau County libraries are seeing this, promoting this, et cetera. Where on Long Island do your roots originally go back to?
Well, I'm not a Long Island guy, but I had to live on Long Island, because the band spent so much time on Long Island. So the first, okay. So when the band first ever came to Long Island as a band to work, never having been there before, except that I had cousins in Valley Stream. I had 9 cousins in Valley Stream. But outside of that, I never really spent time on the island. So the band got a job in the Hamptons in East Quogue, which I had never heard of either. I didn't know what East Quogue was. I know what the Hamptons were, a 20-year-old guy. We were told that we're playing in the Hamptons. I didn't know what East Quogue was. So we get in our cars, we all drive out, and we got a gig that lasted 15 weeks from Memorial Day to Labor Day, 105 nights roughly, 5 nights on, 2 nights off, 5 shows a night kind of thing in East Quogue. So we were 20. And it was a hell of a lot of fun. That was my introduction to understanding West Hampton Beach, Quogue, that whole thing, which I didn't know about. And eventually the band got a, but Mark was from West Hempstead, D was from Baldwin. and we wanted to get a band house. And so the guitar player was in the Bronx and the bass player was from Jersey, but he had no intention of moving in with us. So we got a house, and because I was so totally unfamiliar with Long Island, we were looking in the newspapers for where to rent a house. We wound up renting a house in Harbor Green, Massapequa. Are you familiar with that area?
Yeah, Massapequa is one of those unsung heroes to entertainment because Seinfeld's from there, the Baldwin brothers, Stuttering John, I think, is there, Zebra, right, etc.
Well, you know, the Stray Cats rehearsed there. So here I am, but we weren't just in Massapequa, we were in Harbor Green, which is south of 27. That was the exclusive section.
Yeah.
So we had a house at 33 Sunset Boulevard. What a beautiful address. And it was owned by the head of the FAA, Duane Freer, who was the head of the Federal Aviation Administration. Why he ever decided to rent a house to members of a heavy metal band, transvestite rock band, I don't know. But we were great. You know, we were really good tenants. I was really, you know, I kept the house immaculate. He offered to sell us the house after the year was up, you know, because he said, look, I got to sell the house. And we said, how much was it? Now, you think about what he told me. This is on the water in Harbor Green, on the water, like right by the marina, $80,000. You know, I can't even imagine what that house is worth today. So that was our first, that was the first place we got. And then I moved from there to Garden City. And I lived there for 3 years, and the band was all centered basically in Long Island. So that was my, once I lived there and we wound up playing everywhere, I became extremely familiar with the island, and it became our home base.
When you say playing everywhere on Long Island, there was that legendary Near Riot gig at Adventureland. There was the Nassau Coliseum. You guys literally played every tiny club, every big venue over the years. Yet it's always been weird to me that Twisted Sister is not the number one Long Island cited artist. That, of course, goes to Billy Joel per se. But Twisted Sister, long-term success of Long Island, first ballot Long Island Music Hall of Fame. So that's a little bit of credit.
You know, with Billy Joel, as a matter of fact. You know, we were inducted the same year. Billy, you know, we were a, what do they call, charter members, so first-year members, along with, incidentally, probably the most interesting thing about that event was Little Anthony and the Imperials was also inducted because they were from Long Island. Now, the first show that Twisted Sister ever played was with Little Anthony and the Imperials. So, and why would that be? Because back in the early 70s, a lot of these club owners were like these old-time mob guys who ran these old-time establishments.
Allegedly, right?
Well, you know, allegedly, right? And there were also holdovers from the 40s and 50s and 60s. Yes. So, you know, they would prefer Tony Bennett, you know, and they would prefer Sinatra. You hear all these stories. Yeah, Al Martino used to play this room. This is when music was good, you know, not a bunch of freaking fairies and wacko looking dudes. And like, so these guys didn't care what you look like, but, you know, but they were leftovers. So the thing is, the first show we ever played was for this guy named Carlo at the Satellite Lounge in Wrightstown, New Jersey. And we opened up for Little Anthony and the Imperials. So Carlo went on to notoriously shoot Foghat's amplifiers up at a show. He told them to turn down and they wouldn't. And Carlo took out his gun and he shot the Marshals. That's a well-known story. That's actually online. You can read about the Satellite Lounge in Wrightstown. It held 3,000 people. And that was our first official show.
Just to be clear, an alleged mob guy.
Allegedly.
Who shot up their amplifiers.
He was an alleged mob guy, but he shot it up with real bullets.
Right. Well, alleged bullets.
They weren't alleged bullets. He actually shot in this. So Carlo was known as being a little bit, you know, crazy. And club owners were known by their kind of reputation. So when I met Little Anthony at that Hall of Fame induction, and I said to him, you know, you probably have no recollection that a band called Twisted Sister opened for you, you know, and he goes, to be honest with you, no. I said, but I'll bet you remember the club and the club owner. And he goes, who? I said, Satellite Lounge. He goes, Carlo, that crazy guy, you know. So, yeah. So anyway, that was, but yeah, we were charter members. And I think Joan Jett was a charter member.
Yes. You know? And I'm going to kick a question over to Steve in a second here, but it's the path of family ownership of venues did apply to a lot of infamous Long Island venues, per se. Over the bridge here in Long Beach, there was a series of clubs. Was it the Action House?
Yes, that was all Phil Basile. And so, that was super legendary. Super legendary. Forgetting all the alleged comments one could make about all the interesting people, including Henry Hill, who worked at Speaks, you know, Henry Hill. And you can assume all of the interesting, colorful characters there. They were quite good fellas. That's true. So assuming all that, one of the cool things about the Action House was it was the Long Island version of the Fillmore East. So all the bands that played, you know, Steve, all those shows at the Fillmore, they all played the Action House as a circuit as they came to the New York area. So either before they would play the Fillmore the weekend before or the weekend after, they would all play the Action House. So one day, one of the guys, Larry Todorisi, took me in the back room and he goes, "You want to see the ledger from 1969? And he pulls out a ledger where he shows Led Zeppelin, Fleetwood Mac, you know, how much did he pay? $500, $400. It was all there. It was actually all there. And that was kind of cool. And also he was involved with the Young Rascals. You know, that whole era, obviously the Vagrants, Leslie West.
Yeah.
Quite a heritage of artists that came out of that scene.
I knew that the Action House had legendary people. I knew Pink Floyd, Zappa, The Doors, et cetera.
Everybody.
I never heard that Led Zeppelin played at the Action House in Highland Park.
Yeah, don't forget, too, that Phil managed Jeff Beck.
True.
Beck, Bogart, and Appice. Remember Vanilla Fudge?
Yeah.
And, you know, there was all sorts of interesting stories about what happened when Jeff Beck left Vanilla Fudge. How come Jeff Beck didn't play in the United States for 5 years? There's all sorts of stories about that. So.
I can tell you this, though.
This is the only thing I saw with my own two eyes, besides the fact that my truck was blown up at Speaks one night. And it was set on fire by some disgruntled son, allegedly, of an alleged connected club owner. Allegedly, our truck was set on fire at Speaks. That wasn't allegedly. I watched it burn in the parking lot wearing hot pants and 6-inch heels. So that wasn't alleged. Okay. But you know, that club Speaks was super that was a legendary room. And if you were to ask Zebra, Rat Race Choir, the Good Rats, all the guys in my band, of all the places you could play in Long Island, or all the clubs you played in the tri-state area, which was the most fun? That was the most fun. And Phil did have a great sense of humor. We used to tease the club because the club was packed all the time. There was always 2,000 people in the room. So a rival club owner came to the club one night who did not want to book Twisted Sister because he didn't like our crowd. He didn't like the jeans and the torn jeans and the sneakers.
Right.
And he kept telling our agent, "I don't like the way the fans dress. I don't want the band." And we're like, "Okay, I don't care. I'm not going to like struggle." So he comes to Speaks one night. And Phil Basile told me the story. He's sitting at the bar with Phil at the back of the room. There's 2,000 people there. And I'm making fun of the club. There was a commercial for Speaks on the radio. And we would play the commercial and make fun of it. You know, the commercial was the riff go, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And the voice would go, "Speaks, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. The biggest, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. The best, da-da-da-da-da-da. The greatest bands." And we would do da-da-da-da-da-da, "The biggest holes, the potholes in the parking lot, but da-da-da-da, the most rats in your hamburger, but da-da-da-da, the most ice in your drinks." And we'd always do this, you know. So this guy from Queens comes and he sees Phil at the bar and he goes, How do you handle that, making fun of your club?" And Phil goes, "There's 2,000 people in my room. I don't care what they say about the club." He goes, "And you shouldn't care that the fans want to wear sneakers and jeans," you know. And eventually the guy took us in.
There you go. Well, Steve, we began this conversation by speaking about how you and JJ first connected, per se. What was the creative process like for this book? And I ask that because some memoirs are person talks into the tape recorder, and then you massage that into some chapters and essays. Sometimes it's a give and take kind of conversation. Sometimes the person doesn't remember anything. Clearly, we've learned JJ remembers everything.
Yeah. Yeah. So you already, it's a great question, and you already have an idea of what the process was like, given the last few minutes. So there's a couple of things just based on what you heard from JJ over the last few minutes.
Yes.
Is I want to go back, first of all, to it might have gone by kind of fast, and maybe you didn't actually hear it. But when he talked about the house, and the, them living in the house
in Massapequa,
and the owner wanting to sell it to them because they were such great tenants and took such great care of the place. This is the principle that you got to understand about how this guy operates. Mm-hmm. He's been a business guy forever, so you know him. And you know, your questions about the band and the history and all that, it's a great story. And one of the reasons it's a great story is not just because of the music and the craziness and all that, but because these guys knew what the hell they were doing from the beginning. And it's really JJ's doing that made the business into a band. Mm-hmm. So our process was about not only uncovering the stories. So as you can see, recollection is not an issue here.
Yes. and that's a compliment. Some people remember everything. The only problem is it's from their perspective and it's so skewed. That's not the vibe I got just now.
No, not at all. So the thing is that, so one thing is remembering the details. The other is the ability to be able to tell it as a story.
Sure.
So when he and I first met and we sat down for breakfast and I said, okay, tell me the story. And that, you know, it was press play and that was that.
Yeah.
And he just had this incredible ability to tell the story in a way that was really entertaining. Plus he has this incredible memory.
And the diaries, don't forget.
Yes. And he's, you know, he was always journaling and, you know, writing in his diaries. And I mean, he'll show you ticket stubs from the Fillmore East. You know, he's a collector also and a scholar about rock and roll and the whole thing. So it was just a really good package overall. So what I did was it was a number of things. It was sitting down. We sat down together and I just had him tell me the story. We actually did this a couple of times. I recorded everything, transcribed everything. But then we had discussions about the business side of it, too, because that's a little bit of what I had to bring to the party is, you know, in my background is helping to turn all that into something. What we wanted to do is to have a book that not only was entertaining, but gave good business lessons. Mm-hmm. So a little bit of extraction in that regard, you know, from my part, pulling it out of him, which is not hard to do. But then really my role in all of this was to help figure out what of all this should go into the book and what should be left out. But also to make his great voice work as a book in the written word. Spoken word is one thing. Written word is obviously very closely related, but it's
right.
You know, it's really creating it sentence by sentence and paragraph by paragraph and maintaining his voice. That was my role in this. And it was great fun. It turned out really, really well, I have to say.
Yeah, and I couldn't have done it without Steve, because I'm smart enough to know that given my shortcomings, it would have been a 17 volume history of the Jews. As a Jew, I can say that as a joke. Okay. Just to be clear.
I think it might have been 18 volumes, you know, actually.
Okay.
That's okay.
But it would have just gone on, you know, and I needed someone to go, okay, enough. Yeah, right. I needed someone to kind of be like my wife, but actually like me. Okay. You know, so that really is the case. I need someone like with Sharon, you know, Sharon wanted the book written so I could just give it to somebody at a dinner party and go, you want to email him? Here's his email. Now stop talking about the damn band. And can we talk about anything else, please? I've had it, which I'm assuming is pretty
hair.
Much the problem with all recon tours, you know, because we're wonderful at dinner parties and we're loathsome to the people closest to us. So I knew that Steve would be able to, when you read his books, you would know he was able to do it. And even though I'm a journalist and I'm a writer, I needed someone to sit there and go, okay, cool, but no, cool, but shorten it. Cool, but yeah, but can you tie this to this? You know, so what Steve did for me in the speaking engagement world, he also brought his talents to the book and made a book, a 240 page digestible. You know, people, Steve, I can't tell you how many people say, I love the writing of this book. It's so easy read. I don't have to sit there and try to figure out some sort of cryptic nonsense. It's all logical. And that's what you have brought to this thing, you know, and I hear it all the time, you know, and I take, of course, full credit for it, but I'm letting you know that I personally know that you did it, but I, of course, take full credit for it. Now, I always say that without Steve, it wouldn't have, you know, like Jim, you know, the Marshall amplifiers, you know, Marshall yes. amps, right? You know, right. So Jim Marshall, this is the story that my wife will tell about what it's like to hear these stories over and over again. Jim Marshall was married 7 times. And I said, why are you married 7 times? He said, because every one of my wives got sick and tired of me answering the same question every day of my life. Because the minute a musician would meet Jim Marshall, they go, how did Marshall start? And, you know, this just begins a dialogue. And he goes, they get sick of hearing it. And I understand it. And I wanted this book to be kind of an adjunct to the documentary that was out, because there was a lot of stuff in the documentary that needed also to be filled in. Also, the documentary only took right. us to a point, didn't go beyond 1983.
Right.
This was going to fill up. So it was a lot to do. Think about it. You know, why a memoir? Why a biz war? You know, this whole thing goes back and forth. You know, people, the minute I said I was going to write a book, which was years ago, then the next question is, well, what was it going to be about? That's an annoying question to ask me. If you ask me, I'm writing a book. It's like, now you ask me if I'm writing a book, and now I have to explain to you what I'm writing. It's not just enough that, yes, it's like someone saying, can you get me some concert tickets? Yes. Are they any good? It's like, excuse me. Like, don't ask me for the tickets and then ask me if they're any good. So
you mean no good deed goes unpunished?
Yes. No good deed goes unpunished. So you just stuck with this answer. So I kept going, I guess it's a memoir. Then you remember in Chinatown, my mother, my sister. That's what I felt like. You know, it's a memoir. It's a business book. It's a memoir. It's a business book. It's a memoir. It's a business. You know, like I'm getting slapped around.
Yeah.
And the term biz war kind of, you know, came to me in my marketing sense of coming up with a new word to describe what it is. Truthfully, any book about a business person is a memoir and a business book, because
yes.
how do you, you know, the reason why you become what you become in business is because of what happened to you in life. You know, that's. That you can't, Steve Jobs was Steve Jobs because of what he went through. And so it was, you know, every example of it. So we call it a biz war. And then further to market it, at what point, Steve, did the Twisted Method come as a framework? At what point?
It was actually a little bit later in the process. We started out, you know, there's this discussion about how do we organize the book? Should it be a chronological thing? Should there be some principles around it?
Right.
And then I had JJ speak at one of our events called the Extreme Leadership Experience here in San Diego. And in preparation, I think it was actually in preparation for that talk. This was just a few years ago,
mm-hmm.
where he actually built it around the Twisted Method.
That was the one, right. That was the San Diego talk.
Yeah, that was the first right. time that I actually heard you put it in that context and was like, okay, that's a great framework. And it did change a little bit. Like, we went back and forth on what the second E should be, you know, that kind of a thing. So we had some discussion around that. But but that was a really nice framework. And, you know, like any acrostic or acronym or whatever, you know, they're always a little bit force fit,
mm-hmm.
right? But this doesn't feel force fit to me. I mean, it feels really organic, and all of the elements of the Twisted Method are elements that they use to make that band a success, and they're elements that anybody can use. So for example, if you look at, you know, the second, if you look at the E in Twisted, it's excellence, right? Well, who doesn't need excellence? But what excellence looks like and what it looked like for Twisted Sister is a really interesting take on it, right? So it kind of puts it in a new light. And then as a reader, I can say, okay, well, how does that apply to me? So to be specific, we talk about the boredom of excellence, that excellence is achieved by doing the same thing over and over and over and over again. So what did that look like for Twisted Sister? They played 9,000 shows. That's a pretty big statement. Twisted Sister played over 9,000 yeah. shows. So we proved it by actually putting a list of all 9,000 shows in the back of the book, you know, over several pages in very, very small font. So as a reader, I can think, okay, well, what does that look like for me? What's my 9,000 shows? what do I need to be doing over and over and over again to be, to get so good at it that nobody can touch me on it? And that's a really interesting question that I don't think many people ask themselves.
Yeah. It's the same thing as the 10,000 hour thing. You know, yeah, it's our version of 10, it's yeah. our version of 10,000 hours. And by the way, only because I'm this neurotic, I decided one day to look at those, all the shows prior to our record deal, which is up to 1982. I look at every day we played every year from 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, up to 82, up until the last club date. And I added in all the days we worked and the hours we put in per day to travel and play, mm-hmm. which was 12 hours. And I came up with, in terms of rehearsal and performance days and hours, 9,600 hours we played to as a band prior to the record deal. So when people said we came to England and we just performed like, you know, like we've been doing it for years, yes, of course we had, but we had 9,600 hours worth of, you know, what do they say that it's when opportunity, preparation and opportunity when they meet, you know, that's yes. luck sometimes, right?
I mean, that's talent and opportunity, some equation of that, yeah.
Some equation of that, right? So an opportunity, right, and preparation meet, then you become lucky. Well, that's how you increase your luck. So people said, well, do you think you were lucky that this happened? First of all, I'm not angry that it took as long as it took to make it, because I think we didn't make it because we weren't ready to make it. So we made it when we were finally ready to make it. And we made these adjustments. And we talk about these adjustments in the book all the time. We talk about, you know, as we're going through the tenacity and the wisdom, inspiration, stability, trust, excellence, and discipline, I talk about the understanding that when you're confronted with real problems in your company, mm-hmm. I don't care what company it is, every company's got issues. And if the idea is that you're just like a plane flying through the air and everything is nice and calm, well, that doesn't really exist on a day-to-day basis a lot, but it does. Then you start hitting turbulence, which is typical. And that turbulence can be described as challenges, crises, and then catastrophes. And it's how you respond to these crises and So Steve, I was talking today, I was doing a podcast earlier, and the guy said, you know, you really are the Tony Robbins of metal. And I took it as a compliment to two things. Number one, my experiences and your ability to explain them. That's really what that was. That was a really great compliment, because he said, yeah, he goes, you really are the Tony Robbins of metal. I realized what we did was we took a metal experience and we turned it into a universal lesson plan. And that's what it is. It doesn't matter first of all, it doesn't matter if it's metal. It doesn't even matter if it's country. It doesn't matter if it's rap, hip hop. It's the same rules. And it's the same rules for almost any business anyway. So it doesn't even have to be with the business, which is why I was hired to do Birthing of Giants 2 months in a row, which I did, Steve and Austin. I did two, and they said, and I've done them before. And, you know, Birthing of Giants, they had these guys there whose companies were worth anywhere from $100 to $500 million. And they're there because they're trying to figure out a way to go to hit the unicorn, what, the $1 billion mark, right? So that's why these guys were there. And, you know, they all walked up to me and said that was the greatest thing they'd ever heard in their life. And I'm a high school dropout, ex-drug addict, drug dealing, heavy metal guitar player. Like, what the fuck? You know, what do I have that you haven't understood or thought about or realized or accomplished in your own way without realizing it? Well, all we did was, we were able to verbalize it in an easy digestible package. Maybe they went through the same thing, but didn't know how to explain it to somebody. So that is really the end of the, at the end of the day, as I do these things and I go over the book and I do the interviews, that I'm starting to understand this book is so much bigger than what we thought it was set out to be. Do you think that way, Steve?
I do. I think that, I'm really gratified by the response to it, but in terms of people's enjoyment in reading the book and what they're getting out of it. Mm-hmm. A friend of mine who wrote a review on Amazon, and she disclosed that she was a friend. She read the book because, you know, I asked her to, and she freaked out. I mean, she loved it. She said the problem she had was she was reading it on a plane and she kept laughing out loud and people were giving her dirty looks. So I love the fact that it's funny and all that, and that it's useful. You know, like I said earlier, this, as far as books go, this ain't my first rodeo. And right. what
this,
I'm experiencing-
This is book sixth book, Steve.
What's that?
This is book five or book six?
This is book five.
There you go.
But the point is that with every book, there's, and this is true for anybody who's ever written a book. So when you go to your local public library, and look at all those books on those shelves, the vast majority of those authors will have gone through a similar experience, which is, I wrote this book, now why don't more people read it? You know, there's always that gap between what you think the value of the book is and how many people read it. So we're in that stage right now, because the book is new, that we just want a lot more people to read it. And I feel, as an author, you know, I feel that it's worthy of that. And I think I'm a little bit more objective about it in this case, because it's the first book. This is the first book that I've done as a co-author, right? So I have a little bit more objectivity on it. And so I'll tell you how a typical author's brain works. So, you know, when JJ just said he spoke at this meeting and he got these people with $100 million plus companies, that, you know, my first thought is, how many books do they buy? $100 million company, how many employees do they have? That's one book per employee. If they, you know what I mean? It's not, but the point is that it's not about the sales numbers. I mean, it's always about that. That's the business part of it. But it's about how many people will have the experience of reading it.
If you're doing the loss leader model, where you're just using the book to be able to say, hey, I am on the lecture circuit, hey, I've got a new album, but that's a different kind of success. I just wanted to put that alternative out there.
That's true. I mean, obviously, you know, it is a business. We're business guys, and yes, we, you know, make no apologies for that, certainly. And there's an artist side to this too. It's also an art. And as an artist, you just want more people to be exposed to your art. And that's the way I feel about this book. I want a lot of people to read it, because I think it's that good.
I back that up and I agree with that. And a question that comes from personal experience at JJ here is, I may or may not have worked for a couple of years for a manager who managed Twisted Sister. Let's just say hypothetically, I did work for that person who managed Twisted Sister in the 80s per se. When did you kind of realize I could manage better than a traditional manager? What was your wake up call to all that?
Well, first off, I didn't join the band to be a manager.
Correct.
I joined the band as a guitar player and just thought, that's it. You know, I was happy to have been selected, because I didn't make Kiss, whether Wicked Lester at the time, not that anybody knew if they would be successful or not, but right, I didn't make that band. So it wasn't the first band that didn't call me back, you know, it happened. So I was really thrilled. I knew that my audition was great. And then all I knew was I was being thrust into a new world of the club circuit in New Jersey. And to me, that was just cool enough. Like, I figured these other guys that I'm with were maybe a year older. They were veterans of the bar scene. So I was just going to learn about the bar scene, you know. And I moved out of my house in Manhattan. And I, you know, I kind of have this thing in my head where it's time to take a shot. You kind of close your eyes, put your, you know, fingers in your ears, and you just jump. And you got to jump. You just got to jump. And it was time to jump. So I didn't know. And we had a manager, you know, named Frank Fricchione. We should have thought about this, Steve. We probably should have put the management deal in the book, because, my God, what were we thinking? We gave away, he was getting up to 40% commission, you know, if we made $10,000, which we never made, but oh my God.
That was not the manager I may or may not have worked for, by the way.
I know. can we mention a name, or can we not mention a name? Mention Mark. Is this Mark Puma? Or talk about Mark Puma.
I worked under Mark Puma.
Fine. Okay. So you worked at Freefall.
Yes, I worked at Freefall.
And you worked at Freefall when it was in at the Calder, or was located in West Hempstead, or out in Syosset?
In Huntington, years after all that.
Oh, years after. With Jill Massey, was she from England? Was she with Mark at the time?
She was not with Mark. This was the 3.0 version after Mayhem Records.
Oh, after Mayhem. All right. Yeah. So anyway, so what happens is, I joined the band, and there's a band, and the guy's a manager, and then that band, he wasn't good, and that band broke up anyway. I don't know if it was because he was a bad manager or not. And then the next version was taken over by the drummer who hired me, who seemed to have a business head, and I was fine with that until he stole the gear from me and, you know, smashed it up, and his buddy was a meth cocaine addict, and you know, they conspired to take the truck from me. And then I got disillusioned and said, well, I obviously am not going to be in this business, and walked away from the business for 2 months. When I got back in, two things happened. Number one, I didn't trust managers, and number two, I didn't trust lead singers. Go figure. You know, I'd already been burned by two lead singers, and a bad, and two bad managers. So I figured, could it be any worse? I'll sing. Well, you know, God created Bob Dylan so I could do cover material. I mean, you know, I'm awful, but I knew enough to do bad singer songs. So I could sing Kinks, I could sing Dylan, I could sing Mott the Hoople. You could sing bad. You know, how do you suck doing a Lou Reed song? Sing it on key. That's how you know you blew a Lou Reed song. You know, you didn't have to be close to the key.
Yeah,
you could just do a Lou Reed song. And you know, but we weren't experiencing too much success. So the original version of the band actually became a very successful version of the band. If you look at how much money the band was making towards the end before it broke up, $600 a night was a lot of money to be made when we started making 100, 150. We're making 600, but quickly our money dropped. And my agent said, you gotta sing Zeppelin. And then this became the big issue. It's why I hired Dee. And then that band, I took over management completely, and that band cruised in the club circuit for 3 years, becoming the biggest bar band in the tri-state area. But there came a point when I wasn't sleeping, because it was just dealing with band crap all day long. Because, you know, you could be a rock star all you want, but if you got to talk to the trucking companies at 3 o'clock in the morning, or you got to talk to the lighting companies and this and that and the other, all of a sudden, A, you're not a rock star, B, you're sleep deprived. So after years of sleep deprivation, and I couldn't take it anymore. I was on the verge of a nervous breakdown. And my doctor said, get somebody in to help you. And I brought a guy in named Joe Gerber. Joe came in and I said to Joe, I need to unfreeze my brain. The band's pretty much an automatic pilot. The agent is so-and-so. And, you know, we deal with all these kind of nefariously interesting alleged individuals, which you will familiarize yourself with quickly or you won't. I mean, either you will or you won't. And Joe did. And so he took the pressure off for me for some months. And then I thought about it and said, how much can I do? So I went to Europe to try to get a record deal at the Meetham Festival. And I realized at that point, when I came back to New York, I was going to quit completely and just be a manager. Because being both was impossible. I mean, if you look at who is a manager as a player, there's only two that I know, which is Mick Fleetwood and Steve Miller. And Mick Fleetwood had a whole bunch of guys on his staff. So, you know, and if you read the book about Mick Fleetwood, how he managed anything is beyond me, because it is well written and documented how much cocaine they were doing. I mean, that's not a secret. That's not alleged. That is factual. Yes. I don't know how he's alive, let alone how he, quote, managed. But I got to know his ex-wife. She wrote a book. I said, come on, was he really managing the band? She goes, well, he had a lot of help. Well, you know, you have a lot of help. So I need a manager. I tried to call a bunch of people up, and Mark Puma seemed interested. He ran the Calderon. We kind of knew Mark. And I liked Mark's low-key style. He was very much like me. On top of which, he was very close to Phil Basile. Okay? And Mark, because Mark was a promoter, a big-time promoter, he promoted Zeppelin at Nassau Coliseum, the Allman Brothers at Nassau, for Aerosmith, Pink Floyd. Yeah. He was a big-time promoter, you know? So I figured I could trust him. And he said to me, as long as you're in the bars, I'm not going to commission it, because you already have a self-sustaining business. You know, Mark was never greedy that way. He was like, fine. He goes, you know, you handle that. I got too much other stuff to worry about here. I always considered somebody like Mark, I call him a broad-based conceptualist, because he could sit there all day and philosophize, but sometimes when it came to getting the job done, it wasn't as happy as it should. And Mark came in for several years. And now there's all sorts of debate amongst the band members about whether Mark was good or bad. Now, no one dislikes Mark. Everyone is fine. Revisionist history is revisionist history.
Right.
I look at it and go, should I have walked away at that point and not as much as I did? Or should I have just jumped back in and taken over the reins? The book goes into detail about the psychological damage done towards the end of the band's break. But towards the end of the band's break, I didn't want the band to go on anymore. I felt that the world needed to, I felt that we just needed to end it. Like the dream was over. Like it was a 15-year dream and it was over. I had no desire to run in as a white horse and rebuild, because I was so burnt and tired at the end of the 15 years by 1988 that I wanted out. I needed time to get my brain I needed to heal. It was traumatic. Even though we were 34, 35, 36, and not 22, and not drug and alcohol based, there was a lot of psychological damage going on. And I said, maybe given space and time, we can bring it back. And then I took over again. So by 1990, Dee was gone, Eddie was gone, it was me and Mendoza. Well, if there's no band per se, AJ had quit, then all I have to do is do deals, which is relicense the material. So I set about completely to reformat what the band was about. I was the only one. So I didn't have to answer to anybody. Mendoza was more than happy to go. Any ideas you have is fine with me. I said to Mark, if we have any production issues with the reissues, blah, 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 and remasters, you can do them. And he left me alone. That in conjunction with the bankruptcy, which we go into in detail in the book, the speech I made at the bankruptcy hearing was probably the single most important speech of my entire life. It was completely, I winged it. And looking back at it now, when I talk about my drug past, I talked my way out of 2 drug busts. I would have thought that would have been the crowning achievement of my life, you know, because that's pretty good. Not winding up in prison. That's great. The conversation I had with the judge at the bankruptcy hearing, which is in the book, so you have to buy the book if you want to read it, was probably the most creative thing I ever said, and probably the most valuable thing I ever said to anybody in my life. And let's just say that I walked out of the bankruptcy hearing, instead of feeling depressed that I was bankrupt and all I had was 2 subway tokens and a guitar left, and that was it. And I went and saw my stepmom, and I said, and she knew what I had just gone through. I had gone through a divorce and bankruptcy and no furniture in the house because my ex-wife came in and cleaned the house out. All there was a plant and a futon bed and 1 guitar and 2 subway tokens. And I did have an apartment, which is true. There was a rent controlled apartment, which is sustainable in terms of rent. I had no job. I had no nothing. And she handed me an American Express card with my name on it on her account and said, at least you have this. You can't have nothing. She handed me an American Express card, which I was extremely grateful for. And then I went to visit a guy who owned a gym in my neighborhood who had said something about him having a nephew in the music business and wanted to get involved in the music business. And I said, listen, man, I want to go into business. And I said, I am broke. I am bankrupt. I have nothing. What can you do for me? And he said, I just opened up a pool hall. And if you run it overnight, I'll pay you $400 a week. And you have $400 a week in cash to run the pool hall. And then you and I can figure out if we can get my nephew a record deal. So I worked for 9 months. And this is what he said to me. He said, look, to avoid the humiliation of having people recognize you in this pool hall, if they should come and figure out who you are, you tell them that you're a partner and that you're a managing partner, which is great because they're people who came in and they went, gee, why are you here? I said, it's my place. Well, that makes sense. You know, twisted ended. I bought a pool hall. Like a pool hall was very hip. There was a period of time in New York City. David Brenner had a pool hall. Yeah. Everybody was investing in pool halls. David Brenner's pool hall is around the corner. Very cool. David Brenner had a pool
hall. I went to a gig yesterday at a pool hall one town over where Midge Ure from Ultravox played. So pool halls still have their cash.
so they had it back then. So I had a great, but a funny pool hall story though, I will tell you. One night at 2 o'clock in the morning, I was closing up, 2 guys come in. They were obviously allegedly, not nice guys. And they said to me, excuse, and you have to understand the actual owners of the pool hall were 9 retired New York City detectives. You have to understand this. Their partners were 9 retired from Manhattan North. So these guys come in, they go, would I talk to the owner? I go, well, I didn't say I went, what is about? He goes, well, it's really important. We need to talk to the owner. I said, well, he's not here right now. We're closing. I said, well, you take this number. You tell him you got to make a call. I went, great. I said, by the way, the place is owned by 9 retired narcotics detectives from Manhattan North. Which one of them should I hand the card to? And they said, they took the card back. And they went, on second thought, have a nice night. And I thought, wow, what a way to end a conversation.
it comes back to the being a great talker gave you everything. But, you know, being mindful of your time, I'll give one more compliment and then you take it as you will, or Steve, you weigh in if I haven't addressed that properly. And that's most successful bands are kind of like a 3-act story where there's like the rise, the fall, and then eventually they get that reunion tour, the reunion album, they ride off into the sunset. Twisted Sister, it's not a 3-act story. It's like a 6-act story, because there's like the club days rise. Then there's the Stay Hungry era. Then there's the fall. Then there's the, like the licensing rise. Then there's the playing the European festival circuit rise that most Americans did not pick up on right away. Then eventually there's the American reunion kind of rise. And there's the becoming the Christmas evergreen album rise to it. So it's like three different rises that we got there. All the while you discovered Seven Dust, which is still a successful band to this date. You've had other successes as a manager. It's not over, and it doesn't look like it's going to be over anytime soon. So you guys deserve to write a book about succeeding beyond music.
And let's not forget about the kind of the perennial success in all this, which is I Want to Rock and We're Not Going to Take It, as you know, as licensing deals and, you know, the commercial success of those songs. You're right. It's a remarkable story. It's not three acts. It'd be fun to go back and count how many there actually are, but it's like rise and fall, and not it's even simply rise and fall. It's like almost make it and then don't, and then almost make it and then don't, and then almost make it and then don't. And there are a lot of those little peaks and valleys as well. It's pretty extraordinary.
To the point of We're Not Going to Take It. 2 days ago, I received an email from a fan in Honduras who said, watch this. And he sent me an email of a guy running for president of Honduras using We're Not Going to Take It as his campaign song. This guy didn't support it, but he was just saying, did they have your permission? Let's just put aside the legalities of it. I got an email from a fan in Spain 3 days ago. President of Spain is using We're Not Going to Take It as his campaign song. 2 years ago during Brexit, my daughter, who lives in England, sent me a clip of people singing We're Not Going to Brexit on the steps of Parliament. So let's review here. The four big food groups that came out in 1973, the four biggest bands were AC/DC, Kiss, Judas Priest, and Twisted Sister, all came out in 73. That's a hell of a class. Now, there was a million bands that came out in 73, but these four bands, 50 years later, are gigantic. And Twisted, above all of them, have songs that are known by more people than anybody of all those bands. So whether you like my band or you hate my band, We're Not Going to Take It is the most recognizable song, to the point where you could take a 10-year-old kid and mention Judas Priest. They may not know it. AC/DC may not know it. Twisted Sister may not know it. The minute you go, We're Not Going to Take It, the kid's going to go, no, we ain't going to take it. So we are continuing into the Star Trek Next Generation. I'm grateful for that. The songs are the most licensed songs in the history of heavy metal. I am excited. But to your point about the band's chapters and how it looks, and while Steve does say it's like this, I do look at the grand scheme of things in four chapters. I go, there's the club days for 10 years. There was the video album years that were 6 years. There was the dark ages that was the 12 years of the band didn't reform. And then there was post-reform, which led to the Christmas record, the massive successes in Europe and the massive successes in South America and the massive successes in licensing. Nobody in their wildest imagination could have ever come up with the trail that was traveled to get here. And thankfully, because of Steve's enormous and extraordinary ability to tell the story, that story is finally told in its totality in the Twisted business. And for that, I'm always going to be grateful to Steve for doing it.
Thank you. And before I forget, and before I let you go, I loved the Twisted Sister tribute album called Twisted Forever, which Koch Entertainment put out, where we heard Chuck D covering Twisted Sister, Anthrax. I think
Seven Dust. Seven Dust covered.
Yes. Yeah.
Hammerfall. We had a lot of bands cover. Hammerfall covered us.
9 Days did a great cover of the
Prize. Dimmu Borgir, I think, did Burn in Hell. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, like a super black metal, you know, like let's burn the church and kill everybody kind of band. You know, these are just our people. You know, what can I tell you? Yeah, like a real cross. Oh, Joan Jett covered We're Not Going to Take It. I mean, it was a great tribute record.
Did that have a role in relaunching Twisted Sister, or was it simply the We're Not Going to Take It and I Want to Rock getting licensed enough times that the offers came?
No, I mean, I think it's just a byproduct of continued success. You know, like there was a period of time when Koch came to us where a lot of bands were having tribute records. Motorhead tribute record, this tribute record, that. I mean, look, Motorhead's on our tribute record.
Yeah.
You know, we said to Lemmy, what song you want to do? He went, Shoot Him Down. I went, great, you got to shoot him down. Yeah. You got to shoot him down. You sure you want? Yeah, I want to shoot him down. You sure to shoot him down, Lemmy? Yeah, sure. By the way, on a kind of sad note, Malcolm Dome, one of the most important British journalists in history, and a guy who is quoted on just about every album we've ever released, and who's got the final quote on our new, about to be released double vinyl album, which is coming out in 2 weeks, passed away this morning.
Oh, I didn't hear that.
Yeah, 66 years old. And Malcolm, I had just emailed him 3 days ago saying, Malcolm, I'm going to be in London on November 15, 16. Let's get together for lunch. And I just found out he died. And that guy, I can't begin to emphasize what the British press did to help justify the band's success, helped solidify the band's success. It was Malcolm Dome, Gary Bushell, Jeff Barton, Dante Benuto, Howard Johnston. These are the journalists, these young journalists who considered us uber cool. And then on top of that, Pete Way from UFO, Motorhead, that crew of people at that time were metal in England. And those people helped break us. And Malcolm had been the staunchest fan. And I was just going over his liner notes yesterday with the record label. And then I found out he passed away today. So I just want to say, if you're watching this and you're a fan of any of these journalists, or you've read them for years, that it was sad to see Malcolm, to hear about that from Malcolm Dome.
And that also makes me think about the fact that Twisted Sister was not the only Long Island legendary band that had to go over to England to get that first break, the Stray Cats as well. So two Massapequa related bands. Yes,
and we all rehearsed in the same location. Do you know about this?
I do
not.
We
all rehearsed at Nino's Studios in Baldwin on Grand Avenue. Joan Jett, the Stray Cats, and Twisted Sister all rehearsed at Nino's. And Joan Jett made it first in 81. Stray Cats used to play, you know, we used to see the Stray Cats playing at they were called the Tomcats back in the day before they went over to England. Stray Cats had massive hits, and we all came out of Nino Studios in Baldwin.
Wow. I want to see a second book from you two, but it sounds like there needs to be a book also about the undocumented Long Island music history, because the amount that I've learned from both of you two today is it's off the charts. So the bottom line is this. Congratulations on your book. Congratulations on Defying the Odds over and over and over again. Steve, congratulations on being able to mangle all of JJ's anecdotes into a palatable format that's under 300 pages. It's not like David Lee Roth's autobiography, which I love, but is a lot of pages. And
thank you
both for your time today. You've taught me a lot, and I'm sure anybody who hears this, sees this, has learned a lot as well.
Thank you, Darren. It's been a real pleasure, man.
My pleasure. Thanks, guys. Take care.
Thanks for having us, man. Take care. Outro cast.